Well, good evening.
And welcome to the March 7th meeting of the Owensboro Board of Commissioners. At this time, I would like to ask the City Clerk Beth Cecil to give us, call the roll.
Here. Here.
Here.
Here.
Here.
Good. And welcome staff and welcome all the public, and thank you for being here today, OPD guy. Appreciate it. So at this time, we will have the invocation and the pledge, and be presented today by Commissioner Pam Smith Wright. Please stand.
Will you please pray with me? Dear Lord, we come to you thanking you for this day, a day that you have made, and we will be glad and rejoice in it. As we enter into this holy season, dear Lord, I pray for this commission tonight. Dear Lord, as we guide, give us your guidance. As we direct, give us your direction. And as we lead, give us your leadership. We pray that you will help us as we strive to do, to make the right decisions for this community. We pray for our men and women who are serving in our country, wherever they may be. We pray for our first responders here that protect us, who put themselves in harm's way so that we may be safe. These things I ask in your precious name. Amen.
Thank you, Pam.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, first item on the agenda to recognize and honor any Vietnam veterans that may be here. Okay. Second item is a proclamation recognizing the Colorectal Cancer Awareness Month. Is Jacqueline Anderson here? Oh, okay, good. All right. Whereas colorectal cancer is the third most commonly diagnosed and the second most common cause of cancer deaths for men and women in the United States. Whereas colorectal cancer affects men and women equally. Whereas every 3 minutes someone is diagnosed with colorectal cancer, and every 10 minutes someone dies of colorectal cancer. Whereas only 39% of the colorectal cancer patients have their cancer detected at an early stage. Whereas the survival rate of individuals who have early stage colorectal cancer is 90%, but it is only 10% when diagnosed after it has spread to the other organs. Whereas if the majority of people in the United States aged 50 or older were screened regularly for colorectal cancer, the death rate from this disease could plummet by up to 70%. Whereas colorectal cancer is preventable, treatable, and beatable in most cases. Whereas observing Colorectal Cancer Awareness Month during the month of March would provide a special opportunity to offer education on the importance of early detection and screening. Now therefore, I, Thomas H. Watson, Mayor of the City of Owensboro, do hereby proclaim March 2017 as Colorectal Cancer Awareness Month in the City of Owensboro, and I urge all citizens to join the public awareness campaign about this important colorectal cancer screening. So if you guys want to come around, we'll have a little picture made. Would you like to have your picture made with somebody that's important? That'd be Pam Smith Wright, Larry Conner.
Oh.
Okay. Okay. Item number five is business. Consider approval of the minutes dated 5/7/2017, 5/14/2017, and February 16, 2017. That I would entertain a motion to approve.
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor indicate by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
All opposed? Motion carries. Okay, no ordinance second reading and no ordinance first reading. Counselor, how about 7A?
Thank you, Mayor. I appreciate it. Ordinance 3-2017 is entitled An Ordinance Revising the City of Owensboro's Employee Handbook, Policy 112, thereby including an additional period of validity of 1.5 years to the certified eligibility list of promotional procedures from the date the list is certified. Introduced and publicly read on first reading March 7th, 2017.
City Manager, do you have anything you'd like to share about that?
Yes, Mayor, thank you. Our promotional recruitment for police and fire, that is if you're gonna go from sergeant to lieutenant, for example, is by examination. Once that examination is scored, you become eligible and are placed on lists for promotion. Based on that score, the top five on the eligibility list are then interviewed, and that eligibility list by city policy is valid for either 1 or 2 years. Chief Elam has said that he's really looking for a spot right in between at the 18-month mark, and he's asking the commission to allow a 1 year, an 18-month, or a 2 year period of eligibility for promotion. And in support of the police department, I request that the city commission consider this.
Okay, comments from the commission? Okay. Yes.
Down here.
Do I need to make a motion to for this? No. Okay.
Yeah, I was looking at. Okay, item 7B, Counselor.
Ordinance 4-2017, an ordinance amending the annual budget for fiscal year beginning July 1st, 2016 and ending June 30th, 2017, and amending ordinance 13-2016 to receive funds from the Street Soccer League and appropriate those funds to transition the Legion Park tennis court to a street soccer court, and to receive additional dividends for economic development from the Owensboro Riverport Authority to provide for a one-time expense payment to Owensboro Catholic High School for lease of Chautauqua Park baseball diamond, and to receive funds from the Series 2016D and band bond issue and provide for those bonded projects. Introduced and publicly read on first reading March 7, 2017.
Thank you, Councilor. City Manager.
Thank you, Mayor. There are three elements to this budget amendment. 17-31 concerns the general fund, which is the main operating fund of the city, and there are two parts of the amendment. On the revenue side, this is your authorization to accept a $5,000 donation from the Street Soccer Group to allow us to convert the Legion Park tennis courts into a street soccer facility. It's also your authorization to accept the one-time $150,000 dividend increase in the Riverport over and above their previously budgeted $500,000 dividend. It's also your authorization to expend that $5,000 from the soccer community to build those soccer courts. The second element is 17-32, concerns the facilities maintenance fund, where maintenance for city departments is accounted for and paid from. Several months ago, there was a vehicle accident that damaged the skate park, a skate park feature. The repairs to the skate park element were $8,000 under the insurance check cost you received. This budget amendment is your authorization to use those surplus funds on the Chautauqua Park lease to Owensboro Catholic. That's an expenditure savings in the future for the Parks and Recreation budget. And finally, 17-33 concerns the Capital Projects Fund for financing major capital projects and long-term borrowing. This budget amendment establishes an account to receive the $6.225 million in bonded transportation funds that were dedicated and bonded in December of 2016. It also establishes expenditure accounts for those same funds in the amount of the same $16.225 million. This is not new borrowing. This merely establishes the accounts.
Thank you, sir. Any comments from the commission?
I've got one quick question for Bill. So what's our time frame on the soccer court installation and work? Do we have one yet?
I don't know if Mayor, if Amanda can answer that. It's a question of when we get the funds and their preparedness. I can't answer that. Mayor, if you would recognize Amanda Rogers.
I recognize her.
Welcome back, Amanda.
Thank you, Mayor and Commission.
And to bundle it and keep this short, Chautauqua Park also, what's the time frame on that? Because I know we're giving them money to do some work as well. So.
At Legion Park, the tennis court, we're just basically repurposing that court for street soccer. So the tasks that need to be done there to make that happen are pretty short. It won't take an extensive period of time. Once we receive the check from the group, depending upon when we get contractors lined up, I would anticipate that would be 6 to 8 weeks to have that ready to play. So we're looking for that to be done sometime early summer. And in regards to Chautauqua Park, if you all approve this budget amendment and fund that relationship, then we'll have to sit down at the table with them and finalize a contract. That may take 2 to 4 weeks, and then from that point we'll turn over operational procedures to them, and it'll be in their court at that time.
I have a little information on that from meeting with David and the principal there, so it looks like you all have already met. You've come to some kind of
initial
talks, and
yes sir,
so I asked him to bring back a plan, and he said he would do that as soon as possible.
All right, sounds good.
Okay, any other comments?
And while we've got you here, the Oilers are still going to be playing there as well, or is that a negotiable issue?
I'm sure that would be negotiable, but at the current time we've not had a request from the Oilers to utilize that field for this season.
Okay, thank you.
You're
welcome. It's my understanding if Catholic takes it over, that'll be between the Oilers and Catholic High. Basically it won't be with have anything to do with us.
I would agree. Yes, Mayor.
Thank you. Anything else?
Thank you.
Okay, item number 8, municipal order. Councilor.
Thank you, Mayor.
You're welcome.
Resolution 1-2017, entitled A Resolution Related to the Issuance by the Kentucky Economic Development Finance Authority of Revenue Bonds to 1. Refund the Hospital Revenue Bonds Series 2010A, Owensboro Medical Health Systems, Inc., and the Hospital Revenue Refunding Bonds Series 2010B from Owensboro Medical Health Systems, Inc., previously issued by KEDFA to finance or refinance the acquisition of and improvements to the healthcare facilities owned by Owensboro Health, Inc. 2, to fund reserves for the payment of the principal of and interest on the bonds if deemed necessary or appropriate by the corporation. 3, pay certain expenses incurred in connection with the issuance of the bonds. And 4, pay for the expenditures of KEDFA incident to and necessary or convenient to carry out its purposes, objectives, and powers in connection with the foregoing. Introduced and publicly read for approval on March 7th, 2017.
Okay, any comment from the commission? We had Mr. Condor.
If, would Mr. Strand be able to answer a quick question if possible, please?
Heck no, he can't answer a question.
Well, it's not necessarily a quick question either.
And never is.
Never I'll is. Do my best.
Oh, sure. And again, it may be one of those 6 month after the fact answers. Today, the American Health Care Act was presented. Keeping dependent coverage under age 26, pre-existing conditions, no annual lifetime limits, but repealing individual mandates, employer mandates, out-of-pocket subsidies, and changing Medicaid expansion. As presented, and we know that, yes, we have a long way to go before anything ever gets passed or changed. And knowing the economic impact that the hospital has on our entire region, with these type of changes, will the hospital be able to do everything it needs to do to be financially solvent and provide the services it needs to serve?
We will, Commissioner. I think I think we're in the midst of deciphering that entire repeal and replace legislation. We also are going to have in sometime in April a group to come and hopefully enlighten anyone that would like to come to it and we'll get you more specifics on that. But we are working toward that with our spring board retreat. And so with that, hopefully we can be able to be a lot more conclusive about what the impact would be. But to what we know today, we believe that we can continue to function as we always have. We'll make the adjustments we need to make, which we don't exactly know what those are. Medicaid expansion has a problem of its own in the state. We certainly are aware of that, and we've had conversations with the governor in light of that, and we continue to track that pretty often. And so we expect, though, that things should be okay for us. I mean, we don't expect that it's going to create a problem for us, but although we don't know everything that's in the bill as it stands.
Thank you, sir. I look forward to whenever you can come back, and hopefully it's not a negative impact. I truly
we certainly are not going to let it be if we can help it.
You're not coming back and tell us anyway, are you?
I am.
Are you? Okay.
I'm going to come back and tell you.
Mr. Ray?
I just want one clarification just for the public, that this is not the approval of these bonds, and it's not the city issuing bonds, and it's no indebtedness to the city of Owensboro or the municipality. This is actually a statutory requirement to make aware the public and make aware the local government that this is happening and that the state is involved with the program. So no debt incurrence and no liabilities on the part of the city of Owensboro associated with this.
Thank you, sir. And I want to publicly thank you all for coming and sitting down and spending time with us and trying to get us all up to speed, because it is complicated. And
it is,
especially when you're Kentucky Medicaid system about $1 billion short right now. So we're all hoping that this new act will be a little bit more provider friendly.
We hope as well.
Thank you, sir.
Thank
Any
you.
Other comments? Okay.
Mayor, this would be appropriate time for a motion and a vote on the municipal order.
Okay, I will entertain a motion to vote.
Motion.
On
Second.
The municipal order and the resolution. Got a, any other discussion? Hearing none, all in favor indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carries. Thank you, gentlemen. Okay. No, you have to stay.
Thank you, Mayor.
Yeah, we'll see. Item number 8B, Councilor.
Thank you, Mayor. Municipal Order 9-2017. It's a municipal order authorizing and directing the mayor to execute an application for law enforcement protection program grant funding through the Kentucky Office of Homeland Security in the amount of $10,000, the proceeds of which will be utilized by the City of Owensboro Police Department to purchase 15 soft body armor vests with ballistic plates. No matches required from the city. Introduced and publicly read for approval March the 7th, 2017.
I'll entertain a motion to approve.
Motion.
Second. Okay, City Manager, please.
Thank you, Mayor. OPD has a need for 15 new soft body armor vests with ballistic plates. The Kentucky Office of Homeland Security offers a grant to cover those costs. This municipal order is the Commission's approval to request $10,000 with no match to cover the cost of those vests.
Okay, any other discussion from the Commission? I just have one. Chief, have you got a triple X size? Or, you know, after this next couple of budget meetings, I was just wondering if you had a little. Yeah, okay. Thank you very much. Okay. Any.
Order three.
any other public comment? Chief, you have anything to add? Okay. Okay. All in favor indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Motion carries. Okay. Item number 8C, Councilor.
Consider Municipal Order 10-2017, entitled a Municipal Order authorizing the mayor to execute deeds of easement whereby the City of Owensboro would grant, one, a permanent sanitary sewer easement to Regional Water Resource Agency near the tennis facility located at 2965 Biddle Road, and two, a permanent sanitary sewer easement, temporary construction easement, and a permanent water line easement near Jack C. Fisher Park, and three, a permanent and perpetual ingress egress easement to RWRA and Crown Communication for the purpose of accessing property near Jack C. Fisher Park. Introduced and publicly read for approval March 7th, 2017.
Okay. Okay, I'll entertain a motion to approve.
Motion.
Second?
Second.
Okay. Yes, Commissioner Smith-Wright.
You know, we talked about this this easement near Jack C. Fisher Park and the possibility of odor and all that stuff, and we were told that that would, you know, they were going to try to move it far enough away, but what happens?
What happens?
What happens if, well, after that's done, if there is still that?
Dean. Yeah, sure, if you state your name and address for the record.
Dean Benke with Regional Water Resource Agency.
You know I was going to do it, didn't you?
Yeah, we know the question. We think we have a plan that's going to make that where it's not an issue. There's more extreme measures that can be taken. You know, if we're, our assessments are wrong or something comes up unique in composition of the sewage or whatever that we got to deal with, there's more extreme. We're always trying to save the public money, and you don't like to, you know, throw everything at it, you know, automatically because you got a new pump station, and we'll try to be efficient with that.
Okay.
So you are going to do the double dose on it?
Yes.
To start out with?
Yeah, we have a double treatment system proposed. Yes.
So what kind of complaints do you have to get before you're going to do something else about it? I mean, should we register them, or how's that going to work? You know, if somebody just comes by and they're walking their dog and, you know, and then, yeah. I mean, what kind
of there's
timeline? I mean, I'm just
there's
curious.
Potential. There's human error. You know, things can happen where somebody doesn't do the right job or something, and it doesn't necessarily mean we have to change what we're doing out there. We just have to get more, you know, be more of a watchdog on how it's being done. So we plan on doing that. We do think with the double system that backs it up, that either one of those systems by themselves can do a pretty good job by themselves. So
that's our economic engine, you know, for the ball tournaments, and Amanda's not very happy if it smells bad over there.
Yeah, we've had a lot of discussions about that issue, and we knew we were taking it serious anyway, but we've tried to listen to staff. Good. And
anybody else
take
anything?
Their comments into
Commissioner Condon.
Dean, the other pump station that you have close to the bypass, I'm sure what road that is actually on, close in between 431, 231 area.
Yeah, Higdon Road.
It before had a stench, a smell. Yeah. It seems as if that has subsided a little bit. So have you done something there that will be done similarly to this new plant, or are they two different situations?
No, it's actually one of the two technologies that we're going to use is the same thing that's on trial at Horse Fork Pump Station. And we call it Horse Fork Pump Station. But
thank you, sir.
But it's only been in place for a couple months. So
thank you, Dean. Any public comment? Okay. Entertain a vote, please. All in favor indicate by saying aye.
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 All opposed, no. Thank you, sir. This time we'll have the city manager items.
Thank you, Mayor. I would ask you to recognize Ms. Hamrick to deliver the financial report for January 31st.
Ms. Hamrick.
Yes, Mayor and Commission. I'm happy to give the financial report for the month ended January 31st, 2017. Your general fund revenues through January 31st, 2017 of $30,697,480 were $1,285,754 over budget. This is primarily due to occupational withholding fees and timing of property tax collections. Your general fund expenditures of $27,949,475 were $689,595 under budget, which is primarily due to timing and maintenance, supplies, and debt service payment. Your sanitation fund revenues of $4,470,740 were $169,279 over budget. This is primarily due to dumpster services and sale of capital assets. Sanitation expenditures of $3,230,776 were $763,539 under budget, primarily due to tipping fee cost and timing of capital outlay. Your expenditures in transit fund and recreational fund were all under budget. So at this point in time, it looks like we're doing okay.
Okay. Comments from the commission?
Yes, Mayor.
Mr. Condor.
Page 5, Angela, of the financial report. That is the occupational license revenues, the 1.06?
Yes, Commissioner.
You're through January?
Yes.
764 above?
Yes, we are $764,827 over budget.
That kind of tells us that we're doing fairly well, but we have some jobs out there.
Yes. Yeah, in fact, we did a brief analysis of the revenues year to date and compared them to the same time frame last year. And it looks like it's due primarily to additional jobs and higher salaries. So it looks like a steady good news item.
A steady, the key, steady good news.
Yes.
That's awesome. Thank you. That was it, Mayor.
Okay, any other comments? Hearing none, I will entertain a motion to file for audit.
So motion. Moved.
Second.
All in favor indicate by saying aye.
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 All opposed? Motion carries. Item number 9B, consider personnel appointments. City Manager.
Thank you, Mayor. I'm asking the Commission to consider the following appointments tonight. Whitney Brown, regular full-time, non-civil service appointment as an accountant, effective March 7th. Eric Condor, probationary full-time, non-civil service promotional appointment, fire lieutenant, effective March 20th. Nicholas Ratliff, probationary full-time, non-civil service promotional appointment as a driver, effective March 13th. Caleb Bratcher, Wesley Dunn, and Zane Glass, probationary full-time, non-civil service appointments as police officers, effective April 3rd.
Thank you, sir. Any comments from the commission? Okay. Hearing none, all in favor indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. We didn't motion. Did we motion? I'm sorry. I will need a motion then to consider.
Motion.
Second.
Thank you. All in favor, any comments? All in favor indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed?
Recuse, please.
Mr. Condor is going to recuse on Eric Condor.
Correct.
Does that mean, well, never mind. No. Y'all still going to get along okay, aren't you?
We shall see.
All right, City Manager's comments.
Mayor, I have two final items. The first is I'd like to introduce Mr. Blake Henry, who's replacing Dean Dennis as the director of the Convention Center and the Sports Center for Spectra. Mayor, if you wouldn't mind recognizing him, I would ask him to explain to us why he's here and what he thinks the future is.
Mr. Henry, would you please state your name and address for the record? Do you have a place to live yet?
No, not really. I've been in town for less than 2 weeks. My name is Blake Henry, general manager for the Convention Center on behalf of Spectra. Don't have a permanent address yet here in Owensboro, but I'm happy to be here.
Glad to have you. What's your plans?
I see tremendous opportunity for growth for both at the Sports Center and the Convention Center. So I look forward to working with everyone here in the community to book some real quality events and programming that, and in the process, help drive the local, just drive the economy in the process. So
just curious, as a mindset, when you have a 100-year-old facility and you have a brand new facility, you know, how do you determine how to make both of them efficient? And you know, with, well, am I going to try and get everybody at the Convention Center, or am I going to, you know what I'm trying to say? You know, because that's a big difference in those two venues. And I kind of wondered when the company took it over, how you were going to discern, how are you going to?
Right. Out of the gate, there are some operational challenges with the Sports Center. Just on the ability to hang sound and lights is a real issue. So
what was that?
Ability to hang sound and lights from the ceiling. There's not really a grid there to do that. So everything has to be ground supported for a sound. So we're looking for some workarounds there. But I see some real potential there for a 5,000-seat arena in this market. And the ability to host some really creative programming there.
And there really is no way to play basketball in the new shiny one, is there?
The problem there is the seating. We just don't have the seating.
And these are questions I get all the time. Glad somebody.
I mean, it would be wonderful at the Convention Center to host basketball, but the issue is seating.
Okay.
Yeah.
Commissioner?
The Sports Center is not acoustically fit for like concerts and that kind of stuff because it bounces everywhere. So is there any way that, because people are always asking me, how come we don't have concerts? You know, everybody thought that the Convention Center, this was their own mindset, I guess, was that the Convention Center was going to be a place where they could have
where we could have concerts and big name bands and things coming in. Mm-hmm. And the sports center is not much better, is it, for sale?
No, I'm not looking at that. I don't think it's really been done. I'm looking at the third region, and I'm looking around the sports center and looking at the teenagers in there, and I'm thinking to myself, what kind of program has been done for them? I don't see sound as an issue over there. I think it's a great place to have some shows, and for comedy, special events, and things of that nature as well.
Well, I'm just thinking back in the day.
Yeah, I'm sure that's come up. But
back in the day before my hair was gray, we used to have bands there, and you know, sure. But you didn't care. It just kind of, but now, I'm just thinking that people are more into what it sounds like.
Yeah. Pam, you went to see Kiss whenever they were there in 74, didn't you? That's what it was.
That stuff they play now doesn't sound like music to me anyway. It sounds like noise.
The difference, right?
So do you ever get confused with Henry Blake from MASH?
All the time.
All the time. Okay. When I saw that in the paper, I said, what a cool name, man. Yeah. You could be two people. Well, we're counting on you a lot.
Well, thank you. It's a real pleasure to be here and a privilege. Oh, sorry.
Mr. Glenn.
Yeah, I've got a quick one. Tell us, I think the public would benefit, just give us a brief minute or two about you. You've been in this 20 years. You don't look old enough to have been in this 20 years. So. Yeah. Where did you come from? Give us just a brief bio.
Sure. I started my career in Los Angeles and built out Staples Center, the arena, in 1998. We were the LA Hockey Club, then built out the arena in 18 months and in the process completely revitalized downtown Los Angeles. Then they sent me out to New York City and Manhattan. I ran a 2100 multi-purpose special events and concert venue in the city for over a decade. Then most recently I was with the SMG in Baton Rouge, Louisiana, running a large complex down there. So I chose Owensboro just because there's some fantastic opportunities I see here, but for geographic and quality of life. I find this community a real progressive, and my family right now is in Connecticut. My 8-year-old son is finishing up school and be here for next year, so I'm looking forward to bringing them down and having some fun here in this community.
Welcome to our community.
Thank you
very
much.
We're glad to have you.
Glad to be here.
And good luck.
Thank you.
Okay, next item, Mr. Parrish.
And Mayor, finally, I'd ask you to recognize Fire Chief Steve Mitchell as a public safety announcer for the community.
Hello, Fire Chief.
Mayor, Commissioners. Here tonight to announce, and you might have seen a little bit in the newspaper, once again, the Owensboro Fire Department is partnering with the American Red Cross on a residential smoke alarm campaign. This is about the fourth time we've done this in the last 5 years. Last year, we worked with them, and OFD and Red Cross volunteers knocked on about 650 doors, and we installed over 100 smoke detectors last year. So this year, we're actually have a goal. We're going to try to double that amount. We got about 1,200 doors or so in an area. We're doing the Litchfield Road neighborhoods on each side of Parrish this year. So what we're doing is, if anybody's looking for a volunteer opportunity and they need 4 or 5 hours of volunteer opportunity, and they want to assist in this life-saving program, they can do so by calling 270-683-2438. And that's the American Red Cross. They'll coordinate the volunteers, and this event will be the morning of March 25th.
Okay,
any questions?
Any questions? I would like to also make note of the outstanding reader's right that Lady wrote concerning some excellent work your men did, and women. I guess I got to say that now. We got Lady Firefighter, but I thought that was really cool. That you could tell that just came from her heart big time, and I was going to bring it and read it, but I think most of the people that pay attention to what we do here at City Hall understand that was a great service to our community, and we appreciate you.
Thank you very much, and that group's actually on duty today, and we were able to acknowledge them today with that in the paper. So
great. Thank you. Okay, communication from an elected officials. Pam Smith, right?
Mayor, I just have one comment. I want to
to the Rooster Booster the other day, and the guest speaker was Beatrice Berry. And she went on about our community and how when she first set foot here, she wondered where this place had been all of her life, that it was just a wonderful place. And, you know, sometimes it takes people coming from somewhere else to realize what we have, because a lot of us just take it for granted. And I'm proud of our community, and I'm proud of where we are. And when someone else comes in from another place and says that, it does your heart good. So I just wanted to tell everybody that lives in the city of Owensboro, be proud of what we have here, because a lot of people don't have it.
Yeah, I've always said if we can ever get them here, they tend to want to stay. And I'm kind of blindsiding you a little bit. Could you update us a little bit on the Alerica deal with the vets? Is that open for public? Because I know you had to leave a little early the other day, and I was wanting to have some information if you have some.
Well, Mr. Ken Muich, who is a vice president of Alerica, is meeting with disabled veterans. Mm-hmm. That's his focus.
DAV?
Yes.
Okay.
And the company, wherever they go, they get involved with the DAV and try to work with them and see what they need and that kind of stuff. So, again, that's another company coming from somewhere else and getting involved in our community.
Well, I was glad they had G4 Resource to hook them up. Thank you. Commissioner Glenn.
I just want to commend our Parks and Recreation Department Inspector for running the hockey tournament, the high school hockey tournament this weekend, very successful event, and then also the third region basketball tournament. And I understand, I hope I'm not speaking out of turn, that we're getting that back. Is that right? You can nod if that's correct. Are we? Yeah. So that's good news too. So those are great events. And of course, tonight is the final of the boys between Davis County and Meade County, but we had the girls final the other night. But I think at the Sports Center is a perfect place to have that event. It's just the perfect size. So great job by everybody involved, including Spector, who now runs the Sports Center. Great job.
Who won the state tournament in hockey? Steve, I never saw anything in the paper about it. Do you know? Putting you on the spot. Huh? I knew, I only said that because my hockey boys are here tonight. So Northern Kentucky, they were supposed to win it. Is that correct?
They were like us last year. We went undefeated in one state. They went undefeated in one state this year. But it was a tough, I mean, they came to us afterwards and said that.
In a minute, Shane.
They won, and that was the toughest game they played all year.
Okay, I'm going to let you talk in a minute.
I'm ready.
All right. Anything else, Commissioner Glenn?
I'm good.
Okay, Commissioner Conder.
Just one comment, please, Mayor. Last night, Abby Shelton gave a presentation on our community development action plan for 16-17. And in that presentation that she gave, you could see that in our financials that you have, in total, the community development fund and the home investment program, it's a little right at $1.8 million. And of those funds, they're through grants and all of her hard work to bring in to help low-income families and to rebuild homes and to do a lot of different work in our community that if you go to Mechanicsville and Baptist Town, you see those results, and you're going to start seeing them even in Triplet Twist. And the amount of monies that the citizens of Owensboro, if I'm not mistaken, was maybe around $30,000 of that 1.8. So yeah, you talk about a return on investment, that's a big time one. You talk about that's hitting it out of the park. But I would like if Abby could sometime in the future, maybe if she could present what she did last night to the public again to let them know what is actually going on in Triplet Twist area or other places, please, because people need to understand how that is still going on in our community and will continue to happen. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Commissioner Villada.
I'd just like to thank Ed Ray for a great presentation at the Realtor Association last week. Did a wonderful job expressing some of the great things going on in our community, and congratulations to Angela Clark for being named Realtor of the Year.
Thank you. Okay, most of you realize we've been working crazy on this budget, but we are also doing other things like right and all this stuff. So I just made a little list of the folks that have been through here since 2016. We We had an opportunity to speak to the Chamber of Young Professionals. During the campaign for the mayor's office, I made it a point to talk about trying to figure out a way to get a youth council started in our community so we could get these folks involved, because they're the future of our community, and I think we're just going to probably partner with the Chamber of Young Professionals and do that. And 228, Commissioner Brake, Candace Brake from the Chamber, and Al Mattingly from Fiscal Court, and I, we went to Huntingburg to meet with the Secretary of Commerce, Hank Minke's OPS Brands building, to talk about the opportunity to create the highway from Jasper to the Maceo Bridge. Well, I should say it's Natcher, isn't it? Natcher, is that, it's Natcher Bridge? Anyway, the new bridge. And they're very excited about the opportunity, because that would give us a connector from Indianapolis to Bloomington, to Jasper, to Owensboro, to Natcher Parkway, to 65. Without that opportunity, we end up being on kind of an island, as 69 or whatever the other number is goes towards Evansville, and then across to the Penny Rail. Then you already have Indianapolis 65 out of Louisville, I mean out of Indy to Louisville to Elizabethtown going to Nashville. So we're in this V here. And so it's critical that we continue the dialogue, and we're happy to go up there and do that. I had meetings with Tim Thomas and Terry Carmack, both of Senator McConnell's office. We met with Helen Mountjoy concerning the Arts Council, meeting with Clay Ford, RWRA board member, and also his family involved with the Ford Center. We had, all of us had the meetings with Owensboro Health concerning the retiring of the bond. We had a great meeting with Gary Valentine and Wade Clements on Kentucky transportation issues out of Madisonville. We had the RWR Rate Review Board over at Fiscal Court. We're also a meeting with the Owensboro-Davis County Regional Airport. We got to swear in a lateral policeman. I've never sworn in a lateral policeman, but I've heard that that means he was a policeman somewhere else, right? We had a chamber legislative update at the Commerce Building last Saturday morning. We all are taking turns doing a segment on the radio on Monday mornings, and I have had a lot of positive comments about how well this group is doing telling their story on the radio. A meeting today with David Blanford concerning Catholic High's field and the things that are going on. Our police chief and I were with the men's mass choir at First Christian Church Sunday for an encore presentation. Took a trip to Frankfort with the young, with Owensboro's leadership of Owensboro, to try and get a feel again for what our community has in store for for them. And so those are the things we'll continue to do as we try and work the staff to death on this budget. But we are working in many different facets, and I just wanted to share that with you tonight. At this time, we would have anybody else? Open public forum. All right, members of the audience are invited to address the City Commission on any matter of public concern that was not on tonight's agenda. Comments are limited to issues within the scope and responsibility of the Commission. At this time, I'll open it up for public comment. Shane, your turn.
Attaboy. I'll go first.
Okay.
I'm Shane Cox with Shane Cox Insurance. I wear about 100 hats. Chief Mitchell, I'm the board chair for Red Cross. I think I've got Owensboro High School's National Honor Society going to bring back Club Red, so we're going to get the fire alarms installed. I'm also a board member at the Owensboro Rampage, and I met Mayor Watson. I met him. He coached us years ago, but we talked at the opening ceremonies of the state tournament. It was an extremely successful tournament. He let me know there is a deficit that the taxpayers do help pay the bills at the rink. If you've ever been to the rink or not, the walls are blank in there. We travel in five or six states. We have the nicest arena besides the pro arenas.
Yeah.
You know, we just 2 weeks ago we played North Chicago, where the Blackhawks are. They've got an extremely nice facility, but we played at three really nice facilities. They all have advertisements inside their boards. I brought our state tournament ad. We've got some extremely generous businesses in Owensboro. These are classy ads. That's about a $10,000 program. People begged us to be in this program. They're begging us to pay for advertisements inside the arena. If you don't know much about an ice arena, it's 200 feet by 85 feet. From the viewing stand, you have 414 feet of viewing spaces. If you did that at 8-foot sections, $500 a section, you're looking at over $25,000. If you did 6-foot sections, you're at $35,000. Mr. McFadden here is owner of Westside Auto, and he's been saying for years he would love to wrap the Zamboni. There's tens of thousands of available dollars out there, literally, that could help offset that. Some of it could go to the city to help pave the bills. Some of it could go to youth hockey. I know when Clinton Phyllis Rowell came down 19 years ago from Maine, when Kimberly Clark opened, they were brought down to do that. There were 51 kids involved in hockey, and they were about negative $6,000. There's four times that now, and we're profitable. We'd like to help the city keep that rink going. And I know it's too far-fetched right now. When we go to other cities, they have a second piece of ice, and they have tournaments. The second piece of ice, one in Columbus, of course, we win that tournament every year. Extremely talented kids coming up. It's called the bubble. It's just a canvas dome with a piece of ice under it. No staff members there. It's attached to, you know, other rinks. You go into Lexington Ice Arena, they've got a nice facility, and then they have a pole barn with ice in it. Very low maintenance. If we had something like that, and if we had advertising in there, we could eventually afford to get a second piece of ice. We could have 10 tournaments a year. You've got your mites. These are your travel teams, your mites, your squirts, your puck hogs, your bantams, and your high school team. Each team could have two tournaments a year. I don't know the numbers. Like I said, we just discussed this Friday, so I just came in here on a whim. My goal is to say, let's table this and get back with you guys and talk about having advertisement in the arena. That is my goal. And if we had 10 tournaments, we could, there's no telling how much money we could bring. So, I mean, plus, ESPN Radio, I just got back. We just had our third or fourth live Friday at 5, or not Friday at 5, live at 5. They've been extremely generous. They couldn't get over how exciting hockey was and how nice our arena was, how generous the staff was. Thank you for the Parks Department, because we brought in seven teams. Parking we thought was going to be an issue, but they took care of it. Parking was not an issue because we shared it with Sports Center that weekend.
With the tournament. With the basketball tournament going on.
It was packed. The parking lot was packed, but we got about a third of the parking. And I mean, they had big signs out front, said it was, you know, for the state hockey tournament. People abided by that, and I really appreciate it. They did extra ice cuts between each game.
Tell them what an ice cut is.
That's where the Zamboni, which could say have Westside on it and advertise them, and it wouldn't be at any cost to the city, comes in and they scrape the ice, add more water to it, and it freezes, and you've got a fresh piece of ice. So it helps the skaters. It gets rid of all the divots and things like that. So we had an extra ice cut each game. They vacated the ice part of the facility and put everybody in the lobby, and they cleaned it after every game. That's something you don't see. I mean, we go to some rat holes and play hockey, and I mean, it's freezing cold. You can see your breath. It's 55 degrees all year round inside that arc. I mean, you can literally come in off, a lot of us hang out at the lake or the river, come in flip-flops and shorts during summer hockey and not be cold. I mean, it is definitely the best facility in the state. I know it's probably the best facility in Columbus or in Ohio. We play in Tennessee. Knoxville's come up. Some teams from Nashville have come up. The Predators are interested in our young kids. They let us play at Bridgestone once a year after their game. So you've got pro hockey teams that are extremely interested in Owensboro youth hockey. We won the Silver Sticks tournament down south one year and then went and played second in Canada. That's unheard of for a U.S. team to do that. These kids are going to be freshmen next year on our high school hockey team, these kids that won the Nationals. All I'm asking is let us come in with some numbers and you guys consider letting us put advertising up. It won't be garbage. I mean, I'll leave this here and you can look. I mean, we've got Independence Bank, their ad, deposit your check while cheering on your team.
It's a shame you don't have any passion for this, Shane. I'm telling you, it's awful.
I got passion for everything. Look here. Owensboro Health, proud to support one of the area's coolest events. I mean, this could be on our banner. I mean, you're looking at $500 a year, if not $500 twice a year from each of these sponsors or more. But Owensboro Ice Foundation would be the one that would decide on it. But we want to talk to some of the other teams in some of the other states and see how they advertise, how much they charge. There shouldn't be a deficit at that ice rink. It's too popular. There's too many bright minds running it or the Ice Foundation that we could help offset that help ease the burden with the taxpayers.
Well, we thank you for your presentation, and we'll take it under advisement.
All right. Let me know. You know how to get a hold of me.
I do know how
All
to
right.
get a hold
Thanks,
of you.
Thank you, sir.
A pleasure. Anybody else? Anybody else for public forum? Okay. At this time, we're item number 12. We're going to closed session to consider KRS 61.8101B to discuss the acquisition or sale of property. So could I have a motion to go into closed session?
Motion.
Second.
Second.
All in favor indicate by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Okay. So. Okay. All right.
We're coming back. We're not coming back out.
I don't know. There will be no action. Stevie, no action.